Welcome to Rugby AM. We are here down at Mount Pleasant. It's a 9-foot drop from corner to corner. Jonesy, this is the craziest pitch I've ever seen in rugby league.
It certainly is. It's hard. If you're in toss, you probably want to play uphill, I reckon, first half. Get that over and done with. Try and defend it out and then play downhill. I played here loads of times as a kid growing up. Had some great experiences. Some bad ones. I brought my jewelry as well. That was quite nasty and painful. The other advantage of playing downhill at Batley as well is you've got this great big windmill behind us. That should create a little bit of wind, a bit of vortex, and blow you down there as well.
Right, on today's show, we've got loads to come. We're going to see Danny Kermond, Craig Hughes. We find out what they think about the England team and also what they think about the new Rugby League live game. Have your kids been playing it this week?
They have. They had to clean my car for it, though.
Oh.
Don't give them it for now. Got to get them doing the chores. They clean my car. They've been playing it. And actually, I had to tell them to turn it off and get to rugby this morning.
No
way. They were playing it at the graveyard, Normanton. And they were late because they were playing Rugby League Live 3. But it's a good game. If you haven't got it, check it out.
Now, it's a great community club. We're going to meet some real characters, some of the fans. I just love getting out and seeing the real people that make Rugby League what it is.
It is. It's another great community. Batley, it's a bit like Dewsbury, on the outskirts of Bradford and Wakefield and them kinds of town. And I just love the atmosphere. And again, we've had some hammer, haven't we? Oh, I've had some hammer.
He's had some hammer.
Off the Unslip fans.
We Rhinos! We Rhinos!
Oh, dear. And you all wonder why it's a Leeds programme and I don't ever go to Leeds. It's all great, good banter, I absolutely love it, mate.
Right, let's go out and meet the people of Batley today. Right, pitch down to Barry Eaton pre-game. Barry, how's life at the Unslip Hawks, mate?
Yeah, it's been a tough year. Been really challenging this year. Obviously, got promoted to the Championship last year and we've had a real good dig, a real good effort, but we just got our fate sealed yesterday, so we're going to be heading back to Championship 1, but the boys have done a real good job in terms of having a real effort to try and stay in the league this year.
Danny Morn keeps saying he's trying to blag free kit off you from Leeds lads. He's great to have a character like that around club, though.
He is, yeah. He's a great bloke. He's about 43 now, isn't he?
Looks well, though, doesn't
he? 35, yeah. Yeah, he's good to have around. He's great for morale, and he can still play a little bit as well. So I won't say too many good things about him, though.
Right, today's game, we're down at Batley. I've never been here before, and I can't believe the slope. People have told me, but it's unbelievable.
Yeah, I played here 3 years. I only wanted to play downhill. It's a 9-metre drop.
9 metre.
From try line to try line. I think the full drop is about 9 metres. So yeah, it can have its positives. It can have its negatives. Many a time I requested to play downhill both halves, but the referees wouldn't allow that. So, it's got its challenges. Yeah, it's certainly got its challenges. But, we're looking forward to today's game. Hopefully we can play a good brand of rugby today and enjoy our last game with the boys.
Tactically, do you plan for this pitch?
I think sometimes you can try and plan for it, but that can sometimes scramble the players' heads a little bit too much. It's a blade of grass. It's it's a pitch. It's 100 metres wide, about 68 metres. 68 metres wide and 100 metres long, and the players have just got to go and play their game and go and tackle and run with the ball.
Right, Batley is in the heavy woolen district, and you're very familiar to this area. You played over at Dewsbury, and you're a record point scorer.
Yeah, some records there over at Dewsbury, and then when I came to Batley, I was fortunate enough to break the world record for consecutive goal kicks.
So. How many?
38.
38, without missing one?
Without missing one, yeah. Henry Paul held it at the time. I think he was on 35, and I managed to get to 38. And I think Kev at Leeds got close to it on two or three occasions, got into the 30s, but held it for about 9 years or so, and Liam Finn broke it a couple of years ago.
Do you ever feel like at training you could have a kick-off with Kev?
Listen, Kev's, wow, he's been an outstanding kicker, still is an outstanding kicker of the ball, and... I watch Kevin. I just admire what he does. The way he practices and his methods, his planning and perfectionness is admirable.
But officially, you're better.
Well, I've got a record. Listen, there's still time for Kev to break it. Yeah.
Top man, cheers, buddy.
He's got a job to
he's
do.
He's a charisma, JJB. Well. That's it.
John, it's great to be back with you. I haven't seen you for a few years, and we're having a bit of a light bounce off the Rugby League's two best bald heads, I think. But my memories go right back to 2002 when we went to Fiji together, and we had a bit of a campaign against those boys. It was fantastic. And like me, you'd have had a lot of influences over so many professional players. Are you still loving the game? You still enjoy doing that?
Yeah, I think you've got to do. I mean, if you're not enthusiastic and you're not hungry and not enjoying doing things, you just can't do it because it's too demanding. But the fact is, we've got some great players here who enjoy being here. And you know, part-time players have got to like playing in order to work and then come training three times a week as well as playing. And that's the real joy of it all. So, yes, I'm enjoying it. Yes, I'm still enthusiastic. It's just great fun. And yes, the head's still shining. Yeah.
Forgot to go over Mike today and try and beat him. But it's a great hub as well, isn't it, this place, Mount Pleasant, for the local community. We've got some young kids playing in the background. They remember those exciting times, don't they? And it helps them to grow.
It does, yeah. We've got Batley boys play regularly before all our home games. We've got a girls' team that's going to Australia, which is absolutely fantastic.
Give me a B!
B!
Give me an A!
A!
Give me a T!
T!
Give me an A!
L!
Give me an E!
E!
Give me a Y!
Y!
What's it spell?
Batley!
There's a cheerleading group as well, and there's lots of community work going on with people employed by the club. So we're really pleased with what you know, how our stance in the community, and we're also pretty pleased what we do on the field, because we ain't got the biggest budget, but what we can go out there and scare one or two of these big boys.
Certainly can. And one of the things I wanted to ask you about, I became the first person, I think, in Challenge Cup history to lift the cup off the podium in a suit. Now, I don't quite match some of your accolades in terms of Challenge Cup history, because you've won it twice from being an underdog, particularly with Sheffield Eagles. And I wanted to ask you about the Middle Eights and Batley in particular, who contested for the first ever Challenge Cup final back in the 1800s at Headingley against St Helens. Can the Middle Eights give an opportunity for these type of teams, Dewsbury, Batley, to grow and one day maybe even get back to a Challenge Cup final?
I think what you've got to do is aspire for things like that, yeah, and it's pretty tough at the minute, and it's a bit to do with resources. But I think what you've got to do, you've got to have hope and you've got to have a dream. If you take dreams out of sport, you absolutely destroy it. And that's why I'm pleased that promotion and relegation have come back, and I'm sure, you know, the guys down at Otts will be feeling they're pretty pleased as well at the minute, because they seem to have a real chance this year. And I think you've got to have that capability. There's got to be a path to go from there to there and keep progressing, and I'm pretty pleased with this Middle Eights being one of those pathways.
Well, how have you found the season? How would you sum it up, and what do you expect from today's game?
It's been so near yet so far. We've had 13 games where we lost by 12 or less, so if we could have turned half of them around, we'd have been playing, you know, towards the top end of this bottom eights. So it's been frustrating in ways, but also it's been great because we've seen some great rugby league, some good contests, and as I say, we've scared one or two of the big fellas, and that's what we've enjoyed doing.
John, I just wanted to ask you about what went on at Featherstone. It was quite amusing. And do you know what? Me, and you ask any professional rugby player who knows me, they'll tell you I'm the most gormless, daftest player that they've ever come across. So I'm not judgmental, because I'd have done something similar.
Do you know what you want to do? You want to...
Similar. But when he's kicked that ball, you know, when the hoot was gone and he's ended up conceding that try, how did you feel? Could you laugh? Or?
Well, I was 38 years old when he kicked it, and I was 138 when Sharpie scored the try. So, yeah, it's not the stuffing adders of a bit, and we couldn't understand it. And it's this, you know, I've been in coach a long time, but what it's taught me is that I have to go through the rules every single season with every single player. So, Amy, learn the rules, fella.
The best thing about being a
Batley
fan.
Whoa. Right, we're here with John. We have to do it on GoPro because Tyre's gone for a daft walk. Don't know where Tyre's gone. We want to ask John about what it's like to be a Batley supporter. What's good about it?
Just that it's old-fashioned club, it's family club, and everybody knows everybody. From players to chairman to kit man, everybody. We all know each other. It's a family club.
How long have you been a fan of Batley?
Since 1987.
1987. And who's your favourite player? Ever.
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 Ever. Mick Booth.
Yeah.
Mick Booth, Aussie.
Mick Booth.
Yeah, we're a good
Mick
player.
Big Mick. I want to ask you, as a supporter, has it ever been tempting to want to leave Batley, the smaller club, and go support
Never.
A bigger local one?
Never. I mean, I know years ago when Super League first started, everybody would say, oh, who's your team then? I'd say, oh, Batley. And who's your Super League team? I'd say Batley. And they go, well, they're not in Super League. So, you know, I've never had a Super League team.
Good lad.
It's all about loyalty, isn't it? Well done, Paul.
Yeah. Come on,
have
on.
A good day today.
You too, yeah.
All right, I'm here with John, Kia, and Tony. These guys are in charge of some of the literary parts of the ground. Just tell us a bit about the history and heritage of Batley and this book that you've got down here.
As I said, it's based on interviews with 46 individuals, a mixture of long-term spectators and former players. I interviewed them and they were telling me about their experiences of becoming rugby league players for Batley, how they got into the game, how long they played for Batley, and what the game was like.
Johnny, is there any trends? If I go to Featherstone or Cass, right, talk about their issue down pit, what about around here, Dewsbury, Batley area? Is it in a woolen background?
Yeah, I think so. I think rugby league's a great strength, Jamie, is its community links and the way that it feeds into local areas and people gather around it at individual clubs. And that's certainly the case at Batley. I mean, we were really chuffed at Scratch and Shed to publish this book, because it's everything we're about, really. We're about the community, but we're also about the heritage of the game and where we've all come from, because I think if you don't understand that, then you can't really understand where you are now.